department. Phew! Congratulations on understanding the federal government. But don't celebrate yet. Now it's time to figure out state government. You're lucky. Most state governments are modeled after the federal government. Training a state government won't be much different than training the federal government. You have the same three branches, and except for Nebraska, they are all bicameral. The only difference is the names for each chamber. Some states use Senate or State Senate. Some use Assembly, General Assembly, House of Representatives, House of Delegates, or State Assembly. All you really need to know is what your state uses, and that, with the exception of Nebraska, each state has an upper and a lower house or chamber. We know what you're thinking. Why do we need two almost identical governments? But they're not identical. Remember the states' rights issue we talked about earlier? Well, that's why. Some items are decided by the federal government, while others are a state's responsibility. In a perfect world, everyone would know exactly which rights and responsibilities belong to the federal government and which belong to state governments. Unfortunately, it's not always that easy. Over the years, there have been conflicts over who is responsible for what. So, what are the duties, rights, and responsibilities of both governments? Federalism. Established since the signing of the Constitution, federalism is the sharing of powers between both the national and individual state governments. Earlier, we learned about many of the jobs assigned to the federal government. Below is a list of important federal powers. Make money, declare war, manage foreign relations, trade with other countries, make and enforce laws, make taxes, borrow money. Below is a list of state powers. Ratify amendments, manage public health and safety, oversee in-state trade, make and enforce laws, make taxes, borrow money. So you want to be a lawmaker. Requirements to be a representative: 25 years of age, citizen for at least 7 years, resident of the state. Senator, 30 years of age, citizen for at least 9 years, resident of the state. The good news, bad news scenario. So, we'll give you the good news first. Learning about federal and state governments is pretty easy because they're very similar. Now, for the bad news. There are lots and lots of other forms of government, and they range from familiar to wacky. The reason they are so different is that they are more local. From countries and parishes to cities and towns to commissions and boards, local government becomes very interesting. Let's start with county government. A county is a region of a state that includes smaller cities and towns. Counties have borders, and almost every state has them. See, this is where it gets interesting. Louisiana and Alaska have parishes instead of counties. Connecticut and Rhode Island, counties have no government. From state to state, the power of county government varies wildly, from simple boundaries in some states to handling major functions in other states. The level of power is never the same. In some states, there are county school districts, county emergency services such as firefighters and paramedics, and county law enforcement. In other states, counties provide court services, election services, vital statistics, like your birth certificate, and sometimes libraries, hospitals, and parks. It's always different. In some states, if you need a copy of your birth certificate, you go to the county building. When you put out your trash or recycling cans, in many states, the county picks them up. And who leads the county? Well, there's usually an elected body, which means a group of people that must be elected for a specific term. Sometimes this group is called a board of freeholders, a board of chosen freeholders, a county commission, a board of supervisors, or even a county council. The day-to-day activities in a county are often handled by the county executive or county administrator. Many counties also have a county clerk, a county treasurer, a county surrogate, and a county sheriff. So far, we have the federal government, state governments, and county governments. What else is left? Now it's time to talk local government. Think city hall or town hall. How much power the city or town has depends upon how much power the county has. From big cities to small towns, each situation is unique. Many cities and towns have elected mayors, while smaller ones have managers or are led by the county. The people who govern the city, town, borough, or village are often elected officials that make up a governing council. Besides cities, towns, boroughs, and villages, local government comes in many forms, including school districts, fire districts, commissions, and boards. Some are very public and open with their work, while some are less open. In fact, many citizens have no idea that these organizations exist. More importantly, many citizens don't know that these groups have the power to levy taxes. Yup, taxes. There are so many forms of government that affect so many parts of our lives. Not knowing who they are or what they do could be a very big and expensive mistake. Do yourself a favor and figure out what they do. Chapter 3. How this whole government thing works. T-Bone here. My friend Nick did a good job explaining exactly what government is, but now I'm going to tell you the inside story. Like most things in life, politics and government are not always what you see. You didn't see that one coming, did you? Let's start with the beginning, campaigns. In politics, the campaign is your work and effort to get elected. The amount of time a campaign lasts depends upon the office you are seeking. Generally speaking, the larger the office, the longer the campaign. If you decide that you want to step up and take a stand on issues, then running for office might be for you. Even if you're not the type to run for office, you should still know how this all works, and more importantly, how it is supposed to work. How a campaign should start. Say you have some great ideas and you decide to run for mayor of a small town. In a perfect world, your campaign would start this way. Understand that elected office is a public service before you run. Yep, that's right, it's service. Give it a lot of thought. Seriously, give it some really hard thought. You can't imagine how much time and effort come with an elected office. Don't underestimate how much work is involved. And it's not just the work to get elected. If you're elected, the work requires to serve the people is demanding. Make sure your family is on board and you know what you're getting into. Figure out the money. It takes a lot of money to run a campaign. Find out if your political party, Democrat, Republican, Libertarian, etc., is willing to support your efforts. They may be able to provide you with some money. Also, check your own finances to see what you can afford to contribute while asking friends and family if they would be willing to donate. Find smart people to work on your campaign. You'll need a campaign manager to run everything for you. When I ran against Wanda for student council, Nikki was my manager. Most campaigns will also have someone who manages your schedule, someone who manages the money, someone who manages the media, and even someone who manages your volunteers. Even though Nikki did all of those jobs for me, avoid picking family or friends for those roles. They make great volunteers and cheerleaders, but if they don't have a background in politics, you could have many, many headaches. Decide where you stand. Wanting to run is a good first step, but if you don't know the issues inside and out, and if you don't have the good ideas, you should rethink the whole idea. If you decide to continue, it's time to research issues and solutions. Now, this doesn't mean to look up one story or read a couple of headlines. This means relying on several sources from different points of view and following the issues. The goal is to have a well-rounded understanding of the issues. So if you get elected, you can get right to work. Figure out where your opponent stands. In a campaign, you should know where your opponent stands. Keep in mind, there may actually be places where you both agree. Don't disagree just to be different. Point out where you agree and be able to thoroughly explain where you disagree by using facts. A smart candidate will research an opponent's positions and actions related to issues and avoid digging up personal information on an opponent's family or personal life. Stick to the issues. Create your brand. When you hear the word brand, you probably think of products like cereal and laundry detergent. But as a candidate, you will need a brand too. Your brand should be based upon your ideas and positions. Perhaps your brand is clean energy, or education, or fighting crime. Whatever your focus is, that will become your brand. Once you have a brand, you can create a catchy slogan and order things like signs and postcards. Just remember, your brand should reflect you and your belief. Get to work. The next step is called getting to work. That means going to meetings, writing letters to the editor, participating in debates, knocking on doors, always with your team, never alone, mailing information, and using the internet and social media to spread your message. The goal is to let people meet you and see what you're all about. This is the time to be genuine and be yourself. Not everyone will agree with you, and that's okay, as long as you take the high road. And the good news, the high road never has any traffic. If you get elected, you'll now be responsible for your words and actions, for the issues you support, and for those that you don't. Whether you've elected to represent your school district, your town, your county, your state, or the entire country, you are not there to represent yourself. You are the voice of the people you represent. Never for even a moment believe that you are irreplaceable or that your needs are more important than those you represent. Average length of campaigns around the world. Presidential, prime minister, leader campaigns. USA, 596 days. Great Britain, 30 days. Germany, 42 days. Australia, 56 days. Canada, less than 10 weeks. Mexico, less than 147 days. Japan, 12 days. Electoral college, what? Both words sound important, electoral and college. Put them together and they sound twice as important. But honestly, what the heck does electoral college even mean? You may want to sit down for this one. First of all, the electoral college isn't a place or an actual college. Yep, no classrooms, no books, no professors, not even a football team. So what is it? It's actually a group of people called electors. Each state automatically gets two, which is one for every senator. The remaining electors are based upon how many representatives each state has, which we know is based upon population. So now you're wondering what they do. Well, they actually elect the President of the United States. What? Yep, they elect the president. How is that fair? Well, the electors, who are usually state elected officials, party leaders, or people with a connection to the presidential candidates, are usually picked at the state convention. Except for two states, Nebraska and Maine, all of a state electors must go to the candidate that wins that state's popular vote. Wondering what the popular vote is? That's the votes of all the individual registered voters. In recent elections, the candidate who won the popular vote actually lost the election because of the Electoral College. The number of electors is 538, and the candidate who reaches 270 wins. Visit NikkiFifth.com for a cool slideshow that explains it with pictures. How lots of campaigns really start. Hi, this is Wanda, and I know a little bit about close campaigns and elections. I also know that while we have a lot of decent and dedicated politicians, there are those who are less decent and dedicated. Now that T-Bone has told you how a campaign should start, let's see how lots of campaigns actually start. We know that in the beginning, many people enter politics with the best of intentions. Somewhere along the way, however, many politicians become blinded by power and greed. Remember that part that said an elected office is a public service? Well, not everyone sees it that way. Sadly, there are some elected officials that are only there for their own interests. How can someone benefit from being an elected official? Being an elected official technically makes you a public servant. Yup, doesn't sound very glamorous, does it? But don't let the name fool you. Think about it. Elected officials make laws, they have influence, and they have power. The higher the office, the more power they have. So how do they turn their power into something valuable? The first thing you need to know about special interests. They sound innocent enough, but not all special interests are alike. Special interests are groups of people that share a common interest. One person can be part of many, many special interest groups, and many do great work. An organization that protects water is interested in clean water. A power company is interested in things like electricity. An organization of doctors will be interested in health issues. Being part of a special interest group is not a problem. Over the years, special interests have fought for things like veterans, equal rights, child labor laws, and public safety. Those are great causes, and people who believed in them worked together to rally public support. For special interest groups, one way to support a cause is to lobby. Yes, you read that right. The activity is called lobbying, and the person doing it is the lobbyist. One old story claims the word was used by President Ulysses S. Grant. He used the term to refer to people who would hang in the Willard Hotel lobby in Washington, D.C., hoping to speak to him and influence his decisions. So if lobbying is an act of influencing someone's thoughts and actions, it must be pretty bad, right? Not so fast. It all depends. If you belong to a group that wants to see safer playgrounds, your group might hire a lobbyist. This person would research and gather information, make phone calls, and create a strategy. Part of that strategy would be to reach out to lawmakers and share that information with them. In that case, a lobbyist is a useful tool for achieving a worthy goal. What if, however, you are a food manufacturer and you want to keep the food label measurements in metric so no one in the United States could really understand what was in your foods? That's not a worthy goal, and because of that, the lobbyists might need to get very creative. To persuade, they could take the politician to fancy events and restaurants, or even golfing at expensive golf courses. The biggest thing they can do, however, is to donate money to their campaigns. Yes, campaigns need money, lots of money. The higher the office, the more money they need. Lobbyists know that politicians spend a great deal of time raising money. To get their attention and support, lobbyists donate money. Hold on! Yes, I know what you're thinking. That sounds a lot like bribery. Well, yes, it does sound like that. Someone wants a politician to do something, and they donate a lot of money. Then the politician does it. Sounds like buying a vote. This is an enormous problem. If you ever hear the words campaign finance reform when you're watching the news, this is one of the things they're talking about. Here's an example. A company wants to put ads for cotton candy inside school buses, but they know most parents would be against that idea. They hire a lobbyist to represent their special interest. The lobbyist takes some lawmakers to lunch and explains that selling the ads will raise a lot of money. They even discuss campaign donations. Parents find out and get very angry. They don't want posters that promote unhealthy food choices inside of the school buses and start calling the same lawmakers. The problem. The lawmakers are getting phone calls from the lobbyists and the parents. Soon they will have to vote on the issue. How do you think they will vote? Now, what if the cotton candy company gives the lobbyist money to donate to their campaign? Now, how do you think the politician will vote? Part of the problem may be that campaigns in America take too long. Part of the problem may be that our campaigns have become much too expensive. And of course, a big part of the problem is that some special interests use money to control how some politicians vote. We know you have a lot of questions. How can that be legal? How can that be fair? Why would someone who takes an oath to serve the people vote for bad ideas? Why do these politicians need the money so badly? When politicians who vote for things that benefit them or their donors, do they know that it's wrong? All good questions. Here are some honest answers. In most cases, it's legal, but only because the laws for campaign donations are way too loose. That's not to say there haven't been actual bribery cases, because there have been plenty. From local government to higher offices, many people have been caught and sent to prison for things like bribery and corruption. In most cases, people start off good and do not intend to abuse the power of their office. But too often, They get caught up in the power of holding elected office. They like it so much that they want to keep getting reelected, and that takes money. Often without that money, they cannot get reelected. To avoid feeling bad, they do something called rationalize. This means they talk themselves into believing something they know may not be correct, but they wish to be true. They tell themselves that they are doing such good and important work that it would hurt people if they weren't there to do it. Then they rationalize exactly why it's okay to make decisions that benefit themselves. Go back to the candy posters and the bus problem. Some of the parents who are complaining may make small donations while others don't donate at all. They're all constituents, but they're not all supporters. The candy company, as the lobbyist promised, makes a single $100,000 donation. Who usually gets the lawmakers' attention? Right now, you're probably a little shocked, but wait, there's more. Have you ever heard of the term rider? Of course you have. There's bike rider, bus rider, car rider. Actually, that's a different rider and not the rider that affects everyone's life. This rider is a bill, not a grocery bill or a credit card bill, but an idea before it becomes a law. Suppose you're the politician who is writing the bill to allow cotton candy posters inside school buses. A lot of parents have been making a fuss against the idea, but the candy company has contributed $100,000 to your campaign fund. Now you have to convince the other lawmakers to vote yes for the bill, but that could be a problem. Other lawmakers might not want to vote for your bill. They might consider it too risky. Plus, no one gave them $100,000 to vote for it, so how do you get their support? One way is to add a rider or another bill to your bill. It doesn't even have to be related to your bill. Just any bill that you know another lawmaker would like to pass. And it doesn't have to be just one rider. If you attach enough of your colleagues' bills to your bill, you may get enough votes. Now, everyone who votes for your bill is voting for 12 other bills. And because they're attached, you either vote for all of them or none of them, even if you don't agree with them. That's right. Because they're all attached, every voting member has to vote yes or no to all of the attached bills.